Om Namo Bhagavate Vasudevaya. Om Namo Bhagavate Vasudevaya. All together, please. Om Ajnana Timurandasya Ganandana Salakaya Chakshurum Riritam Yena Tasmai Shri Gurave Namaha Shri Chaitanya Manobistam Sapitam Yena Bhutale Swayam Rupa Kadamayam Dadati Swapadantikam Vandeham Shri Guru Shri Yukta Padakamalam Shri Gurun Vaishnavamscha Shri Rupam Sagrajatam Sahagana Raganatam Vitam Tam Sajivam Sadvaitam Sabadutam Prajana Sahitam Krishna Chaitanya Devam Shri Radha Krishna Padang Sahagana Lalita Shri Vishakam Vitamscha He Krishna Karuna Sindhu Dhina Bandhu Jagatpate Gopesha Gopika Kanta Radha Kanta Namostute Tapcha Kanchana Gorange Radhe Vrindavanishwari Vrishabhana Sutadevi Pranamami Hari Priye Vanchakalpa Tarubhyascha Kripa Sindhu Bevacha Paditanam Pavnebhyo Vaishnavebhyo Namo Namaha Shri Krishna Chaitanya Prabhu Nityananda Shri Advaita Gadadhar Shivasadi Gaura Bhakta Vrinda Hare Krishna 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 Hare 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 Ram 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 Hare Hare So reading from Srimad Gita Upanishad as it is Translation and commentary Srila Prabhupada Text number 33 of chapter 2 chapter entitled Contents of the Gita Summarized. Please repeat Atha Jet Twam Imam Dharmyam Samamam sorry Sangramam Na Karishyasi Tataha Swadharmam Kritimcha Hitva Papam Avapsyasi Atha Chitvam Imam Dharmyam Sangramam Na Karishyasi Tata Swadharmam Kritimcha Hitva papam avapshyasi Atak chetvam imam dharmyam Samagram na karishyasi Tata swadharmam kritim cha Hitva papam avapshyasi Atat chetvam imam dharmyam Sangramam na karishyasi Tata swadharmam kritim cha Hitva papam avapyasi Atha chetvam imam dharmyam Namam na karishyasi Tata swadharmam kritim cha Mavapshasi cha Hitva papam avapyasi Chaitram idamamam Sangramam na karishyasi Tata swadharmam kritim cha Hitva papam avapyasi Atat chaitvam imam dharmyam Sangramam na karishyasi. Tata swadharmam kritim cha. Hitva papam avapyasi. Please repeat. Atta. Therefore, chit, if, tvam, you, imam, this, dharmyam, as a religious duty, sangramam, fighting, na, do not, karishyasi, perform, tataha, then, shradharmam, your religious duty, kritim, reputation, cha, also, hitva, losing, papam, sinful reaction, avapyasi, will gain. Translation, Srila Prabhupada. If, however, you do not perform your religious duty of fighting, then you will certainly incur sins for neglecting your duties and thus lose your reputation as a fighter. Please repeat. If, however, you do not perform your religious duty of fighting, then you will certainly incur sins for neglecting your duties and thus lose your reputation as a fighter. Purport Srila Prabhupada. Arjuna was a famous fighter and he attained fame by fighting many great demigods, including even Lord Shiva. After fighting and defeating Lord Shiva in the dress of a hunter, Arjuna pleased the Lord and received as a reward a weapon called Pashupati Astra. Everyone knew that he was a great warrior. Even Dronacharya gave him benedictions and awarded him the special weapon by which he could even kill his teacher, that means Dronacharya himself. So he was credited with so many military certificates from many authorities, including his adoptive father, Indra, the heavenly king. But if he abandoned the battle, not only would he neglect his specific duty as a Kshatriya, but he would lose all his fame and good name and thus prepare his royal road to hell. In other words, he would go to hell not by fighting but by withdrawing from battle. Mukham karoji vachalam pangam laite grim yad kripa tamam bande shri guru dinatarinam atak chit pram imam dharmyam samagram nakarishyate tata swadharmam kritim cha hitva papam avapyase. If, however, you do not perform your religious duty of fighting, then you will certainly incur sins for neglecting your duties and thus lose your reputation as a fighter. So, in this contents of Gita summarized. So Krishna, he has given so much knowledge to Arjuna in the earlier part of this chapter, particularly about that you're not the body, you're the soul, and has given so many examples. So this is very good theoretical knowledge. Of course, we take it as factual. This is the word Supreme Lord. We're not the body, we're the soul. This factual knowledge. But now, he's telling Arjuna, it's time to do something, right? And particularly Arjuna, you're a Kshatriya, so now you've got to act upon this knowledge and do your duty. I've given you so many reasons. Your objection was that you don't want to kill your elders and your forefathers and all this, but actually you're not going to kill them. They're not the body. And as far as yourself, if you're worried about dying yourself, O Partha, happy are the Kshatriyas to whom such fighting opportunities come unsought, opening for them the doors of the heavenly planets. So if you die in this battle, or these Kshatriyas, they are very happy because they will take birth not on this Bhoom Loka, Bhoom this material plane, Bhumandala, but they'll go to Swargaloka, and there they'll enjoy. Huh? Of course, people of knowledge know that that is not a desirable destination, it is temporary, but it is another argument Krishna is giving. Huh? That you think that you are doing something bad to these people by killing them, but you're opening the doors to the heavenly planets. Krishna's giving that argument. Of course, that doesn't mean wholesale. They will have to have some punya, some pious credits. They will have to be doing battle according to the codes, so on and so forth. But that fact is there, unsought, coming unsought. Arjuna didn't want this fight, we can say, perhaps. But of course, Bhima and Yudhisthira and Krishna certainly wanted this fight. So now it is a religious duty. You see what's the phrase Prabhupada uses? Religious duty of fighting. So here is kicked out ahimsa, Buddhism, non-violence. This is a nonsense idea. And Prabhupada directly criticized Gandhi for this, that he's using the Bhagavad Gita to preach non-violence. But here, what about this verse? If you don't fight, if you don't do your duty, if you don't kill these miscreants, supporters of Duryodhana, who is a big Kali, actually Duryodhana is expansion of personality of Kali. Huh? He wants to degrade society. And if you read Mahabharata, you will see that he was ruling quite nicely, but he was taking all the kudos. You understand this word? All the praise and the congratulation for himself. So that is the demoniac impetus. They want to run society and be the father of society, but they want the credit for themselves. They're not Krishna conscious, they want the credit for themselves. But of course, the devotee situated in knowledge knows that nothing happens without the grace of the Supreme. And he is the instrument, as Krishna tells Arjuna. This is already fought, this battle, by my arrangement. The outcome is there, but you can be an instrument. And then you will get the benefit. So the devotee understands, yes, I'm the instrument of the Lord in every situation. Paramatma is there. Everything is resting on the potency of the Supreme Lord. Paramatma is in the heart. And if we turn to Paramatma, we will get guidance, even better than our karmic gifts. We will get more than what we deserve by bhakti. We will become free of the bounds of karma. But Duryodhana, no. The demoniac mentality is, so much wealth I have got, and I will kill more people to get more wealth, and so on and so forth. It's there later on. So it is a religious duty of a Kshatriya to remove these people, because human society is not meant to be circled around glorification of demoniac people. And this is, isn't that nowadays, you see? Television, movie stars, sports stars. Okay, have sport, it's good. Social interaction, keep fit. It's good for children. Everyone likes a good sports game when they're young, but make them into heroes because they can kick a ball around a piece of field or catch it or hit a ball over the hill or something. This is and turn them into demigods, and give them $100 million contract. Something ridiculous. That's not an exaggeration. That's ridiculous. And then, you know, put them on the television. Oh, he likes blue jackets. Oh, that's wonderful. So this is misdirection of society and people. Sports stars, politicians, they present themselves, right? We saw in Russia, right? They removed God, right? And then what do? They put marks there or Stalin or some Lenin, and then in what in North Korea, move also communism, remove that, and then the fellow died, and they built such a big bronze statue that you get a pain in the neck trying to see the top of it. The whole thing is a pain in the neck. And everybody's, right? They're all starving because nobody has got any impetus, no private endeavor, nothing. And they're all miserable. And if you say anything against the government, they shoot you or kill you or put you in the jail, right? So this is demoniac. Once you remove, we all have a natural propensity to admire and even worship great personalities. But if you artificially put mundane politicians, sports people, and stupid actors, then you're misdirecting society, right? Let them act, okay, but don't make them into, you know, solutions to the problems of life. If you wear a blue jacket, you'll be happy because your sports star does. So this is the ridiculous state, and this is Kali Yuga. So Arjuna has a duty, and all devotees have a duty to fight on this ignorance, particularly in Kali Yuga. We are not the fighting movement, we are the love movement. Hare Krishna, Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare, Hare Ram, Hare Ram, Ram Ram, Hare Hare. This is Dailekri Krishna, and he dispels the ignorance. This is the way we fight. We have kirtan in the temple, but it is not just affecting our temple, but this vibration empowers all devotees all over the world. It empowers pious behavior. Just like if impious people come to the temple, then they show respect. They lose their shakti. But evil people at dusk, at night, they take to forms of intoxication and they become empowered by this mundane activity. So this subtle effect of chanting Hare Krishna empowers goodness throughout the planet and the universe. This is our, and we're not enemy to anyone. That is in Kshatriya. Krishna, Vishnu, he has two things, right? He has the lotus petal for the devotees and he has the conch. And for the wrongdoers, what does he have? The chakra and the conch. And what does Balaram, famous for carrying? The plow, and also he was famous, he trained up Duryodhana in Gada, right? The big ball, what's it called? Huh? Club. Yeah, so devotees must understand that. And therefore, they must not, they must understand that we are on the battlefield. The Bhagavad Gita is spoken on the battlefield. It's not spoken on leather armchairs, sipping brandy and smoking cigar and discussing intellectual ideas. No, it's on the battlefield. Huh? And you must not forget the drama of the situation. This is, you know, sometimes we may enter into the philosophy, but here we can see the drama. There's a huge battle and there's millions of people. If you go to Kurukshetra, it's a huge plain. There's room for lots of millions of people to kill each other. And that's what went on. Literally millions. And they say that they find you know, this red clay, because of all the blood, it's explained in the Mahabharata, that there were rivers of blood and severed limbs were like trunks, and the banks of the river were the killed elephants and all this paraphernalia. So it was very ghastly scene. So this is a real thing. And Krishna is telling him, now, okay, now you know you're not the party, don't go to the forest. Start to fight. And actually, if you consider it, yes, if you're not the body, what's the problem? And that's exactly Krishna's point. of course, it's uncomfortable to give up the body. And it is stated in Shastra that we should pursue life for as long as we could. We should always take medicines and try to be healthy and so on. We shouldn't think, I'm not the body, therefore give up the body. That is foolish. That is demoniac. Krishna says in the Gita, the super soul is tortured by people who perform severe austerities, looking for some Shakti. The austerities are not prescribed in the Shastra, so that is not correct. So we should maintain the body in healthy condition. Why? Because this human body is able to understand this human brain, this whole situation is may understanding spiritual knowledge. That is the purpose of the human life, right? Monkeys are meant to climb in trees and steal your things from the washing line. Right, the pigs are meant to eat the stool. The horses carry conveyances, so on and so forth. But the human is not supposed to be like a donkey, working like a donkey, chasing money. He's supposed to feed his mind with spiritual knowledge, realize the absolute truth, and become liberated from the cycle of birth and death. So, if fools and rascals are presented as the leaders of society, the whole of human society becomes distracted down a dead end, literally a dead end. They only return, they live this life with their so-called smartphones, with their so-called mobile phones. They aren't mobile or smart. A phone is only as smart as the operator. Is it mobile? If you take your mobile phone, leave it on at home, will it move 1 inch? Is it even smart enough to turn itself on? Right? So it's the operator that's mobile and smart. But if he's smart, he'll use it in Krishna's service to enlighten himself. That is the purpose of human life. We must always be searching for realization of the absolute truth. And it is even stated in the Shastra that the human vocal cords, I was discussing with one devotee, is especially designed to vocalize the Vedic message, Sanskrit. You don't hear monkeys and pigs and hogs chanting mantras, but the human body, the whole setup, is meant for chanting the Vedas. And through that, becoming purified. So anyway, I thought that I was thinking about this, the verse, and I was thinking, yes. So, if the Kshatriyas don't do their duty, then we'll become overwhelmed by bad conditions. And what do we see in the world, and India in particular, or the whole world in particular? So it's a very nice, there's a very nice section in Bhaktivinoda's Chaitanya Shikshamrita about how India became so weak, because India, it was conquered before even the Mughals by many people charging into the north, the Muslim crowds, and then they came to stay, and then the British came to stay. The Mughals stayed about 800 years. The British got rid of them in 250 years. So now is a time for India to realize its own destiny. India is built. I was reading one very interesting analysis. It's just like India, you know, it's like a V shape, and it's shaped like a altar. Up on the Himalayas, this is Badrinath. Right, this is like the altar. And then you have also Kedarnath, and then Yamuna and Gangotri. You should try to go to the Chaturdham if you get a chance, they flow. And then in the middle of Bharatvash is Purushetra, the place of Lord Brahma. What is that name? Purushetra or something. The place of Lord Brahma. So the whole of India is meant to worship Naranarayan and Lord Shiva, the great devotees. That is the setup. So, how has India become so fallen and materialistic? Here's some history. It actually goes back in the modern period, and I'm talking about a few thousand years, to the fight between Janmadagni and the Kshatriyas, led by one king, Kirtavir Arjuna, long A. And the Kshatriyas, the sons of the king, they Janmadagni, the father of Parashuram, he was living in the forest doing his bhajan and his meditation and so on. He was a great rishi. And he had a desire cow. So a desire cow is just like a tree. It can supply unlimited milks and ghee and so on for the yagyas of Janmadagni. So the Kshatriyas, and particularly the sons, it's described in the ninth canto of Bhagavatam, chapter 15, they wanted that cow. So of course, they wanted the property of a Brahmin. Not good. But then they stole that cow. And they caused all sorts of trouble to Janmadagni, one of the seven rishis. So his son, Parashuram, decided now it's time to chastise the Kshatriyas. Now, but it was stated later, and his father told him actually that this is not correct, because you're a Brahmin, and a Brahmin, he has his dharma, samadhamma, tapaso, cham, kashantim, arjavam, should be tolerant. If something happens, like a monkey steals his shirt off the, he should think, never mind. He shouldn't go chasing the monkey across the road trying to get his shirt back. He should be tolerant. He should see it as the arrangement of the Supreme Lord. That is the samadhamma. Control of the mind, control of the body, stay peaceful, be tolerant, study knowledge. Don't try and make war with the external world, but rather concentrate on the transcendental abode. Realize that. That's your duty. Leave that regulation to the Kshatriyas. So therefore, the Vedic society is a combination of the Brahmins and the Kshatriyas. The Kshatriyas are meant to regulate society, keep down the bad elements, and the Brahmins are meant to realize the Supreme and guide the Kshatriyas, who guide the Vaishyas, who and all the Shudras engage. But this, because Parashuram took the Kshatriya side, he, for 21 generations, he slaughtered the Kshatriya dynasties. And he was told by his father, Janmadagni, actually you should go and purify yourself. And apparently he is still alive. There's some talk that Mahendragiri, some people say there is one place in Cambodia, north of, you know, the big temple there, what do they call it?
Angkor Wat.
There's one place called Mahendragiri. Apparently around Angkor Wat, they're still discovering in the jungle hundreds of temples of smaller size. And there's one section, Mahendragiri, and there's local stories. But then some people say Mahendragiri may be in South India and so on. But Parashuram apparently is still, of course he doesn't have one of our type of Kali Yuga bodies, but he's still maintaining his existence on this plane. So anyway, he drove out. Now there's a very interesting discussion about this in Bhaktivinoda Thakur's Chaitanya Shikshamrita. You should all read this book, it's fantastic. So I thought we'd read sections of this so you can understand the condition that has come down now in Kali Yuga from this previous ages and this activity. So, yes, so you can read the whole chapter, it's second rainfall, third shower. That's the way It's not called chapters or subsections. It's rainfalls, eight rainfalls. And he calls them showers instead of subsections. Very poetic. So, according to these four natures, Brahman, Kshatriya, Vaishya, Sudra, or well knowing of this, the people of India, Bhaktivinoda is talking in the past, were divided into four varnas. Varna means division. If society is divided according to four varnas, all the work in society becomes effective. This is beneficial for the whole world. That society which recognizes the varnas has a scientific basis and is worshipable by all. Some people may question the efficacy of the Varnashram system, since Europe has attained great feats and fame without having a Varnashram system. So actually that is not exactly correct, we'll say here. Such a doubt has no substance because Europe's history is very recent. Being very bold and energetic, Europeans have taken up all the previous skills, arts and sciences and began to act. That's right, Europeans, they're charging all over the world, right? Opening central banks and robbing people blind. But previously they had a kind of missionary spirit, we're going to spread civilization here and there. So they're very bold and effective. Now the thing is, when these Kshatriyas, it's explained here, we may get to that section. Yes. When these Kshatriyas were being, you know, attacked by, for 21 generations, by Parashuram, many of them ran westward and they went to Europe. And that is why you have this kind of martial organizational ability in the European. And Prabhupada, I heard a lecture by Prabhupada, he says that actually you Europeans are the fallen Aryans. You were chased out of by Parashuram into Europe and you've mixed with the indigenous people, and so you've lost your culture to some extent. And so, but the thing is, if you look at the Greek civilization and then the Roman civilization, these were highly powerful Kshatriya organization, but they didn't have much Brahminical knowledge. And they worship very similar gods to the Vedic demigods and so on and so forth. They had a conception. And also, I've studied the Roman civilization. They say they had many gods in Greek and this and that. But actually, the scholar that I read, he said that actually beyond these different demigods, Apollo and Hades and Hermes and so on and so forth, that beyond them, can somebody deal with that? You see, it's not a smartphone, it interrupts when it shouldn't. So, anyway, behind all these demigods, they thought that there was a one spiritual essence that empowered them all. It's a bit like Pancha Upashana, you know, that you worship the sun, you worship Durga, you worship Shiva, so on and so forth, and then you're actually worshipping the Brahman behind that. So they had some idea of Brahman, and this was in the Roman culture, according to the scholar I read. I didn't read the same thing about the Greeks, but they were an earlier culture, and they had all these demigods and this Kshatriya spirit and so on, organizational ability. And we can understand that perhaps they had the same conception behind their demigods. So of course that is correct. In the Vedas they explain, yes, behind the demigods they're the extended limbs of the Supreme Lord. So they are empowered by the Supreme Lord to rule over the particular elements of the material nature. So these Kshatriyas went there and they brought their understandings and so on and so forth. But the foolish material scientists say that, 6,000 years ago or 10,000 years ago, they don't really know, the Sumerian civilization appeared from the cavemen. right? We were all, you know, they changed according to their latest idea, they changed the dates. But we were all in caves up till 35,000 years ago. And if we wanted to get married, we used a club and, you know, drag the woman by the hair. Well, we came out of the caves and then we started the Sumerian civilization. Now, the Sumerian civilization was very sophisticated. They had these cuneiform tablets, they had a mythology, they had their medical system, they had conceptions correct about the planets and so on and so forth and all this kind of stuff. And they said, where did it come from? Where did their myths come from? If you have a creation myth, that actually entered into the Jewish Torah. They took it from the Sumerians because the Jews, they didn't pay their taxation for 2 years. So Nebuchadnezzar, he took them and turned them into a slave race and put them in Babylon, which is nowadays Baghdad. And they picked up all the Sumerian creation myths and put it into the Torah, and that came into the Bible. And so these Sumerians, they create, anyway, it's a long, we won't go down that angle. But if you study history, where do the Sumerians, this is what they speculate, these nonsense evolution people. But where did all that sophistication suddenly appear? They have got no explanation. The whole evolutionary theory is a way of denying a creator, a big bang. Oh yes, nothing exploded. Well, nothing means it doesn't exist. So how can it explode? They turn nothing into something that exploded. But if it's nothing, it's nothing. It's not something. Nothing is nothing. It's not something. Nothing is the zero before the zero. It doesn't exist. Even a child can understand that. If he's got nothing in his pocket, it means he can't buy any toffees at the corner shop. But according to the scientists, oh, you've got nothing. Be careful it doesn't explode before you go to the corner shop. And from nothing you'll be able to get all the toffees in the cover. It'll create toffees when it explodes, perhaps. So maybe it's better it explodes before you go to the shop. Anyway, so this is the nonsense that's going on nowadays in the name of knowledge. My God. So anyway, the Kshatriyas, they brought their philosophy and ideas and social organization, and therefore, yes, in Europe, they used to talk about the different, you know, there was the aristocrats. I was born in, unfortunately, in that side of the world. And they had the so-called aristocrats, right? Then you had the middle class, they were like the business people. Then you had the working class, right? Now it's breaking down. They're trying to make everyone fight because so on. Anyway, that's another thing. But the thing is, that social organization was there, but Bhaktivinoda Thakur here, he says this is unsystematic understanding, and the Brahmins are missing. So nowadays you can analyze society very easily by understanding that, yes, the Kshatriya, the government function, is meant to take guidance from the Brahmins. But who are they? Now the government function, the politicians, they're all prostitutes. They're bought and sold by the multinationals and the money and the bankers and the money. So the Vaishya function or the wealth function is dominating the Kshatriya function. So the only thing that really matters in the modern society is, does it make money? There's no spiritual direction at all. The Vaishya money function, and then the poor Shudras, they're just used in wars of profit. Huh? They're just sent all over the world, they're brainwashed in schools. Oh, serve the nation. Huh? Which means what? Serve some corrupt Kshatriya whore who is got billions of dollars and doesn't pay any money. So they revolt, and then they make communism, you see. They turn down the aristocrats, right, in Russia and so on and so forth. That's the revolt of the working section, the Shudra class, against the exploitation of the business people. So lacking Brahminical guidance, the Kshatriyas become prostitutes of the business people. And that's the modern day. And they just take millions of dollars, you know, and then when they leave government, they join some as consultant to some big military industrial complex, and then they can steal more money, so on. And if they run out of money, they just print it all, and so on. So it's a completely, so this will collapse. And what does Bhaktivinoda Thakur, let's get back. Yes, so being very bold and energetic, Europeans have taken up previous skills in science and began to ask. However, they lack a scientific organization of Brahman, Kshatriya, Vaishya, Shudra. Although the Aryan civilization is much older, it has remained intact with its original characteristics because of the Varnashram system. This is only existing in India, some kind of idea of the Varnashram system. The rest of the world is just a playground for these ravenous business people to steal and exploit the natural resources, ruin the environment, pollute the land, these demoniac people. The previous Greek and Roman civilizations were much more powerful than the modern European nations, but where are they now? So he's giving a hint that this European civilization, you know, it's going to crash because of the banking system, they say. Those races have become devoid of their previous qualities and taken up the qualities and lifestyle of the modern day, the Greeks and Romans. They have become so transformed that they have no pride in their previous glory, right? That is also the effect of this revulsion against the exploitation. They have no respect for the aristocrats or the so-called Kshatriyas, who are supposed to be a reservoir of history and good morality. Although the Aryan civilization is much more ancient than that of the Greeks and Romans, even now people of India take pride in their ancient heroes, right? Why is that? The Varnashram system remained strong, and thus the culture of the society was preserved and not lost. So, yes. And then Bhaktivinoda mentions, despite the fact that the Ranas were defeated by the Muslims, yet even today they identify themselves as the descendants of Ramchandra. The people of India may have declined to a decrepit state with age, but as long as the Varnashram system is practiced, the Aryan identity will also remain. The Roman and other peoples who were offshoots of the Vedic civilization, in another section he explains that is because, like I say, the Kshatriyas came across, brought it. Who were offshoots of the Vedic, declined as they mixed with the outcast cultures such as the Huns, they were in the region of modern-day Germany, and the Vandals. They eventually, when Rome became corrupt because of lack of Brahminical culture and guidance, then the Huns charged in. Now Europe is so weak, now we have all these invasion over the land from the Middle East, and they're, you know, raping women and attacking and flooding over borders, and the weak Europeans are saying, oh, we should just welcome them and be friendly to them. But that is not the philosophy of the invading horde. If modern European cultures are examined, you will notice that their remarkable features are due to the preservation of varna, based on the intrinsic nature of the individual. Those who have the nature of merchants prefer that occupation, and by that profession they progress. Those who are Kshatriyas join the military. Those who are Shudra in nature prefer to do menial service to the other sections. Actually, no society can exist without a division of varnas. Even in matching for marriage, nature and occupational status have to be considered. The European nations incorporated some aspects of the varnas, but did not systematically establish the varnas there. Civilization and knowledge advance in proportion to the degree of the systemization of the varnas. Now, this is a very important point, because like in our temple, let's not use the temple, but in any institution you will have the intellectuals, like in a university, you have the intellect, so-called intellectuals, of course, they're all fools and rascals nowadays, but they, and then you have the kshatriya function, the security, the management, the collection of funds. Then you have the vaishya function, balancing the books, and then you have the shudras, they work in the different departments. So varnashram is there in every society, like even like the American Indians. They were very sophisticated culture. They're presented as savages on bareback horses, but actually the horse wasn't there. The Europeans brought the horse to North America. I don't know if you know that, but there was no horse, and the Indians used to call it the long dog. Yeah, that was their name. They used to call it the long dog because it actually looks a bit like a dog, a horse. Anyway, so they had a very sophisticated culture. You know, they used to build these mounds and so on, and they had great big cities, bigger than Europe and London at the time and so on. They had all this. You don't get told that because they had all these lunatics with guns killing everything in sight. But they had a sophisticated culture. But then even in the remnants, right, they have the chief, he's the kshatriyas. Then you have the medicine man. He's supposed to be the spiritual, invoking the spirits, right? It's all a bit corrupted. Then you have the farmers, and then you have the working. The young men, they work and they develop into other varnas. So you will, if you examine any institution, you will find that you have the intellectual guiding executive, then you have the management level, then you will have the work financial aspects of the business, and then you'll have the workers. So, but the thing is, Bhaktivinoda is making the point, this word systematic. It has to be recognized. So we don't have to start varnashram. You have to recognize that it's already there and systematically organize on that basis. Do you understand the point? Except in India, all places remain with an unscientific incorporation of the varnas. Of course, Bhaktivinoda is speaking in the 1800s here. He's not talking about the modern-day India, which is just going down the Malecha-Yavana route at top speed with their immobile and unsmartphones. That is why India alone is known as Karma Kshetra, the place of action. Now, I want to get you the section where, yes. Yes. It's very fascinating. Everyone should read this book 100 times. Yes. Then we come back to what I was saying earlier. Yes, anyway. Then there's a lot of, he's explaining about Treta Yuga. I'll read this little bit, it's interesting. Is the system of Varna in India now in a healthy state? No. The system was established in a perfect way but gradually deteriorated, and this is the reason for the troubles and degradation of present-day India. What to speak of year 2000, this was 200 years ago. If that were not the case, India could have taken the role of elder brother who in old age and retirement could give good instruction to other nations. The reason for India's deteriorated state should be deeply considered. The Varnashram system was established in India at the beginning of Treta Yuga. Yes, you see, in Satya Yuga there was no Varnas. Everyone was Hamsa, there was one. Everyone was just meditating on the Supreme Lord. At the time, the Aryans had advanced knowledge. The rule was established that people who took up a Varna according to their nature and getting a qualification through that varna, they would carry out their duties and work designated by the varna. So according to the nature, the guna, you would have a particular varna. But now this corruption has come by what? You get your varna in the corrupt, foolish system by birth. Janma karma, Krishna doesn't say, he says, guna karma vibhagasha. You get your varna through your guna, your qualities. And then your karma is done after your guna. Your personal qualities. By following this system of ashram and varna according to nature, the work of society continued smoothly, according to nature. Varna was decided solely on the basis of nature for those people whose father had no varna. There's a story in the Vedas about one rishi. A young boy came to him and he said, I want to be your student, please teach me the Vedas, the Vedic conclusion, spiritual knowledge. And the rishi asked him, who is your father? So the boy said, well, actually, my mother was a maidservant in a rooming house, and she knew many men, and I was born from that. So he was the son of a woman of easy virtue in the rooming house. So the rishi said, you're being truthful, you're brahminically inclined. I'll take you as my student. So you see the point. Nowadays people say, I'm a Brahmin, but they're working in a factory. They don't know anything. This is corrupting the Varnashram system. No reference to nature, just birth. And this is why the Brahmins are becoming rejected, because they're not performing their duties. Like in Vrindavan, who are the most, the pandas, they hang on the car and spitting pan. Yes, I'll take you around the temples and all this behavior. Panditji, you know, all this. Oh my God, they're the most degraded, all full of bhang and taking heroin. Yes, it's all going on down there. I've seen it in my own eyes. And I'm a Brahmin. I'll take you around the temples. Wait a minute till the heroin wears off. Yes. It's actually what's going on. Varna was decided solely on the basis of nature for those people whose father had no varna. Jalabli, Gotama, Janasri, Chitra, Kreta were examples from Vedic history. These are different sages who weren't born in so-called Brahmin lineages. From the Kshatriya dynasty of Narishyanta, the great rishi Jetukarna appeared. So, and there's many examples, he gives a whole list there. There are many examples like this in the scriptures showing that birth is not the only qualification for occupation. All right? If you go to a doctor, you don't say, is your father a doctor? No, you say, what's your, you know, before you operate on my toenail, I want to know what is your training? Oh, my father is a dentist. Open your mouth. Oh, maybe it's that one that's hurting you. Maybe it's that one. No, this is foolishness. You have to be qualified. When the actual system was practiced, the glory of Bharat was as strong as the noon sun. All nations worshipped the inhabitants as Bharata's rulers, administrators, and teachers. Egypt, China, and other countries used to take instruction from the people of India. Yes, you know the who's that guy, the yin and yang guy? Yes, anyway, they're sages. They all studied in India. And you know all the Kshatriya arts, you know the... That all comes down. I've seen them in South India. I saw one man, he put out his arm like this, and somebody broke a concrete brick slab, or, you know, one of these tiles, and his arm went half an inch. And there's a big tile, he whacked. And he was showing all these incredible feats. This all comes from India, all this. It comes from the Vedas, ultimately. The Varnashram system continued purely for a long time until Janmajagni and his son Parashram claimed to be Brahmanas, though both had the mentality of Kshatriyas. So this drove a wedge between the Brahmins and the Kshatriyas. As I explained earlier, the Vedic or the Varnashram system particularly is meant to a combination of realized, spiritually realized Brahmins and Kshatriyas. They combine. And then the Vaishyas and Sudras, they work under that direction. By following a Varna contrary to their nature, out of self-interest, they created friction between the Brahmin and Kshatriya classes.
As a consequence of this deviation, the seed of enmity between the two classes and the procedure of judging Varna by birth became fixed. In the course of time, the system of Varnas, without reference to the inner nature of the person, entered covertly into the Manusamhita and other scriptures, without possibly of attaining a higher Varna. Out of frustration, the Kshatriyas created Buddhism, so to destroy the Brahmana Varna. You see? So once the Brahmanas judged, then they needed some philosophical system, then Buddhism became powerful in India, and that meant ahimsa, and that meant they became weak in their duties, just like Krishna is telling Arjuna here, stand and fight, do your, if you do not fight, you will become a disgrace, you'll lose your reputation. So then, once they became influenced by Buddhism, oh, you should just be peaceful and ahimsa param dharma, then the Muslim hordes eventually started to make a foothold in India and then dominated for 800 years. And if you study the history of what the Muslims did in India, it's incredible what they did, but it's all kept quiet because we don't want to, we don't want to stand on the tail of a snake. But this is actually the reason became, don't stand on the, it bite you, right? That's how, it's intimidation, that's the system of Kali Yuga. Don't discuss things, no, just blow people up and get your own way that way. It's a great preaching tactic. But eventually they're going to crush by the weight of their own sinful activity, very shortly actually. As a consequence, the seed, yes, therefore no, sorry, where was I up to? Ah, yes, created Buddhism to destroy the Brahmana Varna. You may not know, but in Jagannath Puri, when Buddhism was very strong in India, prior to the Muslims' invasion, they thought that Jagannath was a Buddhistic deity. They completely lost their knowledge of their history in Jagannath Puri. Actually, Shankaracharya drove the Buddhists out, actually, from India. Philosophically, he defeated them. He said, your conception of nirvana, which means voidistic non-existence of the forest of material life, where did you get that? You're rejecting the Vedas, because the Buddhists, they reject the Vedas. They say, the Vedas are the basis of human civilization, their knowledge of how to live in the universe. So the Buddhistic idea, reject the Vedas, and then ahimsa, just be peaceful, and then everything will be nice. So, but the thing is, that's nonsense, because not everyone is going to agree. Huh? You may, you can't, there's an old saying, you can refuse somebody anything except a fight. Mm-hmm. What does that mean? That means if somebody attacks you, you've got to fight, right? You can say, I want your glasses. No. You can have this garlic. No. I want your glasses case. No. But if somebody attacks me, I have to fight. Huh? So the Buddhistic idea is completely impractical. Somebody, once Gandhi was asked, say you had a daughter and she was being raped, would you be peaceful? Huh? Because he's the latest presenter. So the thing is, Krishna is telling Arjuna, you've got to fight. But Buddhism says, oh, be peaceful. So then India, because they lost the Kshatriya function through this Buddhism, which was exacerbated by the action of Parashuram attacking the Kshatriyas, 21 generations, India became very weak. When the conflict between exploitation of position based on birth by the Brahmins, now you see that also happened. So that Kshatriyas, they started to reject the Brahmins, and then the Brahmins said, well, no, we're Brahmins because we're born Brahmins. So this is Krishna's arrangement ultimately, the Devas, to bring in Kali Yuga, you see. because previously in Dwarpa Yuga, especially Treta Yuga, Varnashram was very strong. And that means you keep away the bad elements in society, the Kshatriyas, and you keep society on a spiritual function. But once that Kshatriyas and the Brahmins then started to say, we're Brahmins by birth. And then the Kshatriyas started to believe in Buddhism because they don't want these Brahmins, you see. So this split, and it started from Parashuram chastising Kirta Arjuna, Kita Varjuna, because they stole the sacrificial cow of Janmajagni. Yes, now look, listen, this is very interesting, because he's a great scholar, Bhaktivinoda Thakur. You should all take the benefit of reading this book. Right. With no brahminical qualities, thus brahmanas in name only began to write scriptures with their own selfish interest at heart. Right? The Manusamhita, it entered into the Manusamhita, which is an organizational document for human society. Therefore, Prabhupada said that it's not really to be. Wait 1 minute. Without their kingdoms, they began to support Buddhism. Oh, sorry. Kshatriyas, without Kshatriya qualities, were defeated in battle. Without their kingdoms, they began to support Buddhism. Vaishyas, without the Vaishyanata, began to preach Jainism. By this act, the great mercantile community, right, the strong in India, you must know, the strong in India, the Jains are very strong, very close-knit mercantile community, and they're usually Jains. You know, they walk around with their sadhus, walk around like that. By this act, the great mercantile community became weakened. Laborers without shudra nature, that means without performing good behavior and fidelity to the higher classes, without qualification for works of a specific nature, became thieves and dacoits. Right? Of course, in Vrindavan, everyone is a sadhu. But make sure you lock your cycle. Right? So if you go to, if you try to get something repaired in your house, you just get a load of lies and overestimates and cheating mentality. It's disgusting. Laborers without sudra nature, that means without fidelity, without qualification works, became thieves and dacoits, right? Running without any scriptural reference, the country became under the control of the Muslims, right? Because the Muslims, they had their strength, you see, whereas the Indian society fractured. You see, the sudras and were becoming criminal class and druggies and so on. And they were becoming, the mercantile class were just keeping their money, not spreading it into society on good works. The Kshatriyas were becoming Buddhistic or hating the Brahminical, not taking the Brahminical country. The Brahminical culture was becoming based on birth, not quality and activity. And so, and therefore, there's a story about the Muslim. There was one Muslim invader of India, and the night before the battle, he called one of his ministers and said, why are there all these fires? He was looking at the enemy, you know, the Hindus. And he says, oh, well, and his minister told him, well, the Hindus, those that are from one caste will not eat the food cooked by another caste. So they all have their own little fires, the different, and there was hundreds of them. So then the Muslim said, we're going to win, because this is an army divided amongst itself. Whereas the Muslims have this idea, Allahu Akbar, and we're all brothers, and so on and so forth. So they charged into India, and they started to rule the place with an iron or a bloody fist. Killing everything in sight who objected. But the least they were, you know, they were in charge. But all the Hindus were just arguing about who's a Brahmin, who's a Kshatriya, what you should do, no, you should do that. And so it's like a box of sand. There's no cement to tie it together. So that, therefore India, this is Bhaktivinoda Thakur. Shipping country companies entered. This must be a reference to the British. So the Muslims were in charge for 800 years. Then the East India Company came. The concept of service vanished. Gradually the influence of Kali deepened. The present pitiful condition of India, once the controller and teacher of the whole world, right? Even in England, I was brought up in England, and we knew that India was the place of religion and sadhus and yogis. You know, they had some, there was some cultural. Actually, Gandhi visited England. He went to Manchester, and he went to the cotton mills, and there's photographs of him in his, you know, his cloth. And the mill workers loved him. They thought he was a real character. Once the controller of teacher of the whole world, it's not because of old age. You see, India's the corruption of our nation, not because of old age, like the Roman and the Greek civilization, but because of the corruption of the Varnashram system. Now listen to this, what Bhaktivinoda writes, and this was more than 150 years ago or something. By the desire of the Lord, the controller of all living beings and the propounder of the rules and regulations of human society, that's Krishna, may there arise again in India an empowered person who can establish the Varnashram system. The writer of the Puranas, like us, also expectantly awaits the assistance of such. Plus Kalki avatar. So anyway, this is it goes on, and he develops all these different points. It's fascinating analysis. And if you want to understand philosophy, the way he analyzes in the eighth rainfall is fantastic. So you see, the point is that when Varnashram is there in society, you'll always get the intellectuals and the spiritual people, you'll always get the governmental types and the organizational type, you'll always get the business type people, and you'll always get the Sudra type people that just want a job and want to have good situation. And it's also analyzed that if you look in the modern day, communism is the philosophy of the Sudras. Capitalism is the philosophy of the Vaishyas, and monarchy is the philosophy of the Kshatriya class. And anarchy, not in the sense that you go around blowing up government buildings, anarchy means, what anarchy actually means is that they don't believe there should be any government. This is actually right-wing philosophy. But what it means in real philosophical anarchy means, for the Brahmins, means that they are ruled by the Vedas and their austerity and their realization of the Supreme. So they're not under the Kshatriyas. You understand? They may be subject to examination by the Kshatriyas to see that they are doing their duties properly, but they are not to be governed by the Kshatriyas. So therefore you have, and nowadays in the modern world, this is what you see, isn't it? There's communism, that's failed. Then you have capitalism, that's failing at the moment because they're just printing money until it's worthless. It's all going to crash eventually. And then you have the Kshatriyas. The Kshatriyas are just the prostitutes of big business. They're all the front men for big business. They're bought and sold by big business. Get in power and then change this regulation so I can make $1 billion. Start this war so I can supply the helicopters and guns and bombs there completely. And what are the Brahmins nowadays in the modern society? Generally, there was a big bang and everything came from nothing. The most ridiculous idea in the whole world. Huh? Even a child won't accept that. If you tell a child, Mummy and Daddy, where did I come from? Well, there was a big bang and you just appeared one day. Is that what happened for my sister? Yes, of course. So we found you on the doorstep after a thunderstorm. It was only a little bang, so you were a little baby. Your sister, she was a bit fat, it was a big storm. So this is the state of Brahminical knowledge in Kali Yuga, right? This is the condition. Why? Because there's varnas are there in human society. Like we say, you have your workers, your business people, your kshatriya type, you have your brahminical, your intellectual class. But it's not systematically, and the food for these, the guidance for this is not accepted, the Vedas. And that, the British did that, right? They came here and they said, oh, it's all mythology. The Mughals came for 800 years and said, we'll just kill you. And the British came here and they said, oh, it's all just stories, right? And so throughout India, people think that the Vedic knowledge, Bhagavad Gita, the Srimad Bhagavatam, the Vedas, not everyone, of course, that is all just mythology, stories. Even though if you actually study it under, as we are graced by Srila Prabhupada and the great acharyas by Bhakti, then you see the sublime nature of it. I've been studying for more than 40 years, and the more I study, the more I see the perfection of this knowledge. Veda means knowledge. It is the handbook. Just like when you have a so-called smartphone, you need a manual, right? How to operate it. It's only as smart as the operator, but people are pretty dull. They have to go to university to study how to use a smartphone. Anyway, so they have a manual to how to use a smartphone. If you buy a computer, you know you have a guidebook. Even you buy a motorcycle, they'll give you a little guidebook. How to, you know, run it in and how much mileage you should get and whatever. They'll tell you what to do. So it is atheism to think that there is no guidance, that it's all a big bang. But actually, there's a creator. Then if you create something, then you will give guidance how it should be used. So if you believe that the creator is a person, then you should expect that there is a handbook on the creation. So theistic people, they will have no problem with accepting the Vedas, but then they should apply their intelligence. Tadami buddhi yogam tam. They should study and systematically apply the Vedic knowledge. But then varnashram, that is for people who are not taken to sadhana bhakti. Sadhana bhakti means shravanam, kirtanam, vishnu, smaranam, padasevanam, archanam, bandhanam, dasyam, sakyam, atmani, vedanam. That is sadhana bhakti. Then you concentrate on the Supreme, and then you are free of varnashram obligations. But not everyone is going to do that. There's going to be a wider body of people, and they should be organized according to varnashram. So, and here is that reference. I just read it this afternoon. It came, by the desire of the Lord, the controller of all living beings and the propounder of rules and regulations of human society, may there arise again in India an empowered person who can establish the Varnashram system. So Prabhupada said, yes, now I've established Bhakti Yoga, Bhagavad Gita, Srimad Bhagavatam, Shravanam, Kirtanam, Vishnu, but I also want to establish Varnashram for the general mass of society. But it has to be implemented systematically and intelligently, not. So we're trying to do a little bit in that way, in that direction. That is the duty of us as members of ISKCON. But that means we should learn, just like Krishna here is giving Arjuna knowledge, and then he's saying, now you fight. If we don't know, if we don't study the books of the great acharyas, if we don't become immersed in Bhagavad Gita, Srimad Bhagavatam, then how will we apply anything? We just stay on the sentimental platform. So therefore, all the great acharyas have expanded the Vedic knowledge with their commentaries. And Varnashram, and it's very interesting because Bhaktivinoda Thakur is generally understood to be the great propounder of rasa scriptures, right? discussions on the Ashtakala Leela and so many things in Bhakti Yoga. But here, he's emphasizing Varnashram. And you will see the same thing in Bhakti Siddhanta Prabhupada. So the Vedic knowledge has that two prescriptions. For those who want to take to Bhakti, Shravanam, Kirtanam, Vishnu, Smaranam, Padasevanam. And then there's Varnashram for the general mass of people. It stabilizes society. And then within that, they can take to devotional activity. But if everything is a big hodgepodge and everything is unstable, how will people practice spiritual life? As Prabhupada said, morality starts with a full stomach. Right? Right? You're very moral when you have a full stomach. Yes, I'm generous to the world. But if you're starving, then you're going to push everyone aside to get a loaf of bread. So that is a modern condition. Not just India, the whole world is like that. Everyone is anxiety for food, shelter. They can't even support a wife. Huh? It's stated like that. You can't even afford a wife, and one man can't get a job because the taxation is so strong. Two people have to work day and night, and then they buy a mortgage, and it takes them 50 years to a little ramshackled hut with two houses and one toilet or some two rooms. So this is because the demoniac people have captured the government and the brahminical aspect. There's no God, it's all a big bang, just get the money. So this is the hellish condition, Kali Yuga. But by chanting Hare Krishna, Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare, Hare Ram, Hare Ram, Ram Ram, Hare Hare. Do not underestimate the potency of the Sankirtan movement. Just see what Prabhupada achieved. So we should continue with that spirit and confidence. Thank you all very much. Srila Prabhupada ki jai. Any questions? We got 2 minutes, 5 minutes. Anyway, get this book. Feed your mind. Yes, please. I'll give you a quote from Prabhupada. So Bhaktivinoda happens to be an acharya, one of the acharyas. He has left behind him many books, Chaitanya Shikshamrita, Jaiva Dharma. These are very important books. They're in Bengali and Sanskrit. So we are trying to present Bhaktivinoda's books, that means all of his books, also in an English translation. Gradually you will get them. Srila A.C. Bhaktivedanta Swami Prabhupada, London, 23-9-1969. So don't let any donkey brain say that this is not one of Prabhupada's books. This is particularly recommended. These are very important. Gradually we are trying to present them. So it's presented. Take advantage. Yes.
Scientists, show the world how these people are cheating everybody in the name of intellectualism and leadership and authority like that. He was really saying.
Yes, and so you have to attack the root. That's the best place to attack the root. So the root of this whole modern society is the Big Bang, is it not? That's their whole philosophy. You see, the Brahminical idea converts into action. You see, the ideas convert into action. Thinking, feeling, willing turns into action. So the modern, and that's why Prabhupada wrote Life from Life and so on. He wanted the Bhaktivedanta Institute to put the theistic conception. Because so there, the root of their idea is that there was nothing and it exploded. And then that's the first myth. Second idea is, after the explosion, it gathered together and became conscious in the form of a cell. Second stage of their myth, right? And then those cells, by chance, somehow or other, mutation or interaction with the environment, developed into you, and you, and me, and it all happened by chance. So you have three stages. And then number four is, and I was doing research once, and I went on one famous, they call them neo-atheists, and he was saying, he was asked, what's the purpose? He said, actually, there's no purpose to the whole thing. The Big Bang, the development of consciousness, the differentiation into different bodies, it's no purpose. That's what he said. But now, this was on YouTube, if I'd have been there, I would have said, well, why are you purposely going around telling people that there's no purpose? That means you're out of harmony with the universe. And that's very unscientific. So shut up and go back to your leather armchair, sip your brandy and smoke your cigarette and write your nonsense. Huh? There's no purpose, right? There was a big bang, it became conscious, it became lots of different bodies, and then there's no purpose. So this is their actual, this is the guiding light of modern society, and look what's happening. Look what's happening. Huh? And so as a response to this, now you have this fanatic idea, you know, that's flooding through the Western and destroying European culture, and America is under, you see. Why? Because it becomes so weak. So weak, the Western society. It's going to collapse. It's become so weak because of these demoniac ideas. Big Bang, became conscious, became lots of different bodies. There's no purpose. So then you get some fanatics. We're the only way, and if you don't follow us, we'll kill you. That's a much stronger call to arms. There's no purpose. It's all a Big Bang. Huh? You see the point? So that's what's happening in the modern context. Well, the liberals, well, the liberals means anything goes, right? I'm liberal. So that means, oh yes, you should be free to do anything. Blow up airplanes, kill people, mutilate your women, and so on and so forth. Got to be liberal, it's all okay. That is the ultimate in weakness. So here's what, this verse, that's why I'm saying, this verse, it says, stand and fight, Arjuna. So without Kshatriya function, and that's what Krishna is telling Arjuna, stand and fight. So we should realize that, we're on the battlefield of ideas, and that translates into battlefield of physicality. Okay, Srila Prabhupada, Srimad Bhagavad